finish him. Beat the guy now. Ram the gun.
What is this?
Good day, sir.
You are watching Jackie Pan in my house.
Yes, King Kong, sir.
Eh? King Kong. You've never heard of ACTV before in your life? ACTV is very educative, informative, and there are football sport. There is entertainment. There are a lot of things you can even attend lectures here. All you know is watch all those nonsense artists and do nonsense or you watch nonsense on TV. Eh? Last night you almost came in bed with your fist.
It's not me, sir.
Eh? And you wake up every morning, the bed will be so rough like you've been fighting for your dream. Eh? That's the reason why you have F's in your courses like
this. Especially
made for you.
I have it last semester.
E, we E by pounds on you. Very stupid though. We are changing that section to ACTV right now. And oh god, the baby will have been first born. Eh? Stupid boy.
Good afternoon. You're welcome to this series on MTH 305 vectorial mechanics, and in this lecture today we'll be looking at the position vectors. In the last class we considered the del operator and we made explanations of how the del operator works on scalar fields, vector fields, and we talked about the implication as it works with the divergence of vectors. We talked about the curl of vectors and we talked about the gradients of vectors. We also talked about solenoidal vectors and conservative vectors. And in this class, we would continue by considering the position vector. In position vector this afternoon, we'll be looking at what are position vectors? How do we make use of them? In sense of position vectors, we'll be talking about descriptions of particles or masses of bodies that are in motion with respect to the three-dimensional coordinates. And we will be using the concept of position vectors to define certain physical properties of, say, physical quantities. For example, we'll be talking about the velocity of a body in motion. We'll be talking about the acceleration of a body in motion. We'll be talking about how to use the position vector to determine these physical quantities. Now, a position vector. For us to define a position vector, we need to understand diagrammatically what we meant. We would be looking at, let's have a three-dimensional plane, and we assume that there is a curve in motion, and on the curve here, we have a particle. This is our x-axis, our y-axis, and our z-axis, and this position, this is called P. There is a mass here called P. And this is the origin. This is the curve, the path of motion, C. It's a path curve. It is expected that this particle P is going to be moving along this curve C on this. Now, we say that if a particle is moving in a three-dimensional along a path, we can describe the path of that particle by defining a vector quantity R. We define a vector quantity R, such that the R is moving from the origin to that particle in an arbitrary point on the curve C. And this is going to be defined in terms of time, time t. Why we'll be defining in terms of time t is because this is at time t. Now, if this particle is moving again along this curve, it means in another position here, there's going to be another time, say t1 or t2 or t3. So if it moves here, it will be in another time, say t1, T2 and T3. So we'll be defining this position vector, this vector R, as the position of the particle P relative to the origin 0 at, say, time T0. So if it moves to this place, it will be depending on time as the motion moves on. So we will define a vector in terms of the axis x, y, z, and we would have r to be defined as x, which is a function of time I plus y t j plus z t k. Now this is the definition. This is how we define a position vector. And generally we can just say x I plus y j plus z k. So the position vector of the particle p is defined as x I plus y j plus z k. And here we can also define the unit vector in the direction of this position vector. The unit vector is defined as r, the position vector, divided by the magnitude of the position vector. And so we would have this, noting that our r is x I plus y j plus z k. Now the magnitude of r is given as the square root of x squared plus y squared plus z squared. This is the unit vector. This is the unit vector in the direction of the position vector r. Now once we've been able to get this, from this now we can begin to describe the motion of the particle p with respect to velocity, acceleration, and we can even define it with respect to the kinetic energy. We can use it to define so many physical quantities. Now the first physical quantity we would be looking at is velocity. We would look at velocity. Now, we note that by definition, the velocity of a particle whose position vector is r is given by now, if we remember in our physics, we define the velocity as change in displacement with respect to time. As our displacement is changing with respect to time. So here we'll be finding the derivative of the position vector with respect to time. And since we know that this is our position vector, x I plus y j plus z k, it means that the velocity will be given as the x I plus the t plus the y j plus the z t k. This is what we have. And also from the velocity, we can define the acceleration. We know acceleration is rate of change of velocity with time. So it means that our acceleration is defined as the rate of change of velocity with time. So if we have this, and don't forget that our velocity is change in the position vector with respect to time, then we'll have d dt of the r dt. And this is d squared r dt squared. So it means we differentiate r twice with respect to time. And we can easily write this as the squared xi, the t squared, plus the squared yj, the t squared, plus the squared z, the t squared k. Now, we've gotten an expression for our acceleration. Now, it means that from this case, on the other hand, we can as well determine our position vector given any of these two, whether we have acceleration or velocity. We can determine our position vector. And how do we do that? We should note that our acceleration is given as change in velocity with time. So it implies that change in velocity is acceleration multiplied by the t. So if we integrate both sides, we would have Velocity is given as integral A, the T, plus constant C. Let's call the constant of integration C1, the first constant of integration as C1. Now, we've gotten an expression for the velocity. For us to find our position vector, we note that the velocity is given as change in R with respect to T. So it means that our dr is equal to v the t. So if we integrate r, we would have, and this would imply that we have r equals integral v the t plus c, say c2. So once we have that, we can easily substitute and get, so from here we can actually get, so since we know that for the first one, that's the value of our velocity, and we are using velocity to integrate. So it means here that our R is going to be integral V. The velocity here is the same thing as this. So we can slot in that value there. So if we slot in the value, we have double integral A, the T plus integral C1 T plus C2. Now this is what we would have. And don't forget here that A can be written as the V, the T. So we can put it and then we'll get our value. So this is what we have for the values of our R. Noting that C1 and C2 are constants. These are constants. So we can integrate. Now, so we are going to use these concepts to determine the velocity, the acceleration, as well as the position vector, given a particular motion of a vector, or a particle, or a moving body. Now, the another thing we need to note again is the parametric representation of the position vector. The position vector can be represented in terms of other functions. So each of the functions can be depending on several variables. For instance, time. It could depend on time as it will be defined. So let's look at an example. We look at an example. Example 1. We are given here that the position vector of a particle is given as x equals sine 2t, y equals cos 2t, z equals exponential 3t. We are to find its original velocity and acceleration. We are to determine the original velocity and acceleration. Now, for us to do this, we need to define what our position vector is. Noting that R is given as x of t I plus y of t j plus z of t k. Our x, now this is a parametric representation. Noting here that x is defined in terms of t, y is defined in terms of t, z is defined in terms of t. So it means as t is changing, each of these variables x, y, z will be taking different forms. They'll be changing as well. So we can now slot in these values. Then it means that we will have sine 2ti plus cos 2tj plus exponential 3tk. This is our position vector. Now we have been told here that we are to find its original velocity and acceleration. Original velocity and acceleration. So since we are to determine the original velocity and acceleration, it means at the initial time, at the initial, since they said original. So that means, what is the velocity at the origin? So it means at the initial state is when t equals zero. So first thing we need to do is find our velocity. So here, our velocity is given as the derivative of t. Derivative of r, differentiating r with respect to t. So it means we have d sine 2t with respect to t plus I, this cos 2t j, the t plus d exponential 3t, the t k. So if we define, if we differentiate this, now when we differentiate our sine, if we differentiate sine 2t, we would have cos 2t, then this is a function of a function, because 2t is a function, sine is a function of 2t. So if we differentiate it, we would actually have 2 cos 2t I. Now, differentiating cos 2t, we would have minus sine 2t, then this is a function of a function, we have minus 2 sine 2t j plus, now this is an exponential function. So if we differentiate it with respect to t, we would have 3 exponential 3t k. So here we would have our velocity as 2 cos 2t I plus minus 2 sine 2t j plus 3 exponential 3t k. Now, our original velocity is when t is equals to 0. So we'll substitute 0 here. So we have 2 cos, substituting 0 for t, we have 0, we have I minus 2 sine 0 j plus 3. This is exponential 3 times t. This is 0 k. So from here, we would determine our values. And we know that cos 0 is 1, sine 0 is 0, and exponential 0 is 1. So this will give us 2i. This is 0. So this goes away to give us 0j plus 3k. So here it means that our, that means the component with respect to the y-axis gives us 0. So we have 0. So it means here we can write this as 2i plus 3k. This is our velocity. What this is telling us that the velocity along the y-axis is 0. So the velocities are only depending on the x and the z-axis. Now for us to determine our acceleration is differentiating the velocity with respect to. Now, for us to do this, if we do this and just substitute it here, we might not get it right correctly because we are going to evaluate it at the initial time, zero. So the best thing for us to do is, this is the value we got for velocity. So we can differentiate this, or we say we differentiate this twice. We differentiate it again. So if we do that, noting that V gives us this. So it means we would have D, the t, 2 cos 2t I minus 2 sine 2t j plus 3 exponential 3t k. We'll differentiate this again. So on differentiating this, this is 2. If we differentiate cos 2t, we would have minus 2 sine 2t. Multiply by these 2, will give us minus 4 sine 2t I, then here we have minus 4 cos 2t j plus, this will give us 9 exponential 3t k. And on this note, if we now substitute the value for t equals 0, since this is our acceleration, then it means here that this would give us minus 40 sine 0 I minus 4 cos 0 j plus 9. This is exponential 0 k. So here we know that sine 0 is 0. Y cos 0 is 1. So we have this as minus 4i minus 4. Sorry, beg your pardon. This is 0. So we have 0i. This is 4j plus 9k. So we would have here to just give us minus 4j plus 9k. That is our acceleration. So we've determined the acceleration and the velocity at the origin, the initial time t naught, using the concept of our position vectors. Now we would proceed to the second example, and from the second example we would be able to determine our position vectors from our acceleration and our velocity. Now in the second example, example 2, we have that a particle started from rest at the origin with acceleration A equals 60i minus 30j plus 12k. We are to describe the path of the particle. We are to describe the path of the particle. Now, in this example, we need to understand this concept of what this is saying. Let's assume that a car is at a park, and the car is to travel from Lagos to Ibadan. The car is at rest. The moment the car kicks and begins to move, it's expected that the car will move with certain acceleration to pick up to move. Now, from the initial point where the car has not started, it is assumed that time t equals 0. So we can assume here that this particle was at rest at the origin. And as it begins to move, its acceleration for motion was taken as this. We are now explained to describe the path of the particle. Now, it means if we describe the path of the particle, we should be able to locate the particle as the particle is moving with respect to time. We can determine what is the acceleration after 10 minutes, what is the acceleration after 20 minutes. We can determine that. Now, we are being given acceleration. So what we do here, we start from the fact that we have acceleration is defined as the V, the T. And so it implies that our V is equals to integral A, the T, plus constant C. So once we know that our acceleration is given as 60i minus 30j plus 12k, we can substitute that into this to have integral 60i minus 30j plus 12k, the t, plus c1. So if we integrate this, with respect to t, since integral is summable, we can just solve that. So this gives us 6t squared divided by 2 minus 30, this is I, minus 30tj plus 12tk plus c1. This is our velocity, and this gives us 3t squared minus 3t squared I 30tj plus 12tk plus c1. Now, here our c1 is the first constant of integration. This is the first constant of integration. So we don't know what our C1 is. So we'll try to calculate our C1. And don't forget that they told us that this vehicle started from rest. So it means if it started from rest, then the implication is that at the origin, the velocity is expected to be 0 because it was not in motion before. Now, they said it started from rest at the origin. At the origin, it means no motion. It's starting from rest. So it means the velocity at the origin is expected to be zero, and the time it's starting from rest is also zero. So it means V equals zero at T equals zero. So from these two, because here at this point we have three unknowns. V is unknown, T is unknown, and C1 is unknown. But because of the fact that we know that V equals zero at T equals zero, we can get the value of C1 when T is equals to zero. So substituting the values of our V equals zero and T equals zero gives us that zero equals to, this will give us 0i minus 0j plus 0k plus C1. So from here we know that our C1 is what? Zero. Our C1 gives us zero from that. Our C1 gives us zero. So once our C1 gives us zero, it means that our V now can be written as 3t squared I minus 30tk plus 12tk. This is what our velocity is. Now, from the velocity, we can get our position vector. Noting that our position, our velocity is given as this. So it means that our R will be integral V the T plus C2. Now, we can substitute this. So it means that we would have integral 3t squared I minus 30tk plus 12tk the T plus C2. So this is our position vector R. Now, this position we integrate, and this gives us 3i minus 30t squared 2k plus 12t squared 2k plus C2. This is our position vector. And this will actually give us 3t raised to the power 3 minus 15t squared plus k plus 6t squared k plus C2. Now, this is our position vector. And since they told us that at the origin, it means our R should be zero. Our R should be zero. And so it means at the origin, R is zero at T equals zero. So we can substitute that there. So it means zero equals, substitute zero here, zero I minus zero K plus zero J K plus C2. So this also implies that C2 is equals to zero. So if C2 is equals to zero, we would now have that our R is described as T raised to the power 3i minus 15T squared J plus 6T squared. Now, this is the expression, the path for our position vector. We've been able to describe the position of the vector as that. So we can from here determine the position of this particle as it's moving along the path at any point in the curve. Now, with this, we've been able to see that several quantities, physical quantities, can be described based on the position vector. And on this note, we would be summing it up that the basics for determining our position, our vector, our physical quantities such as velocity, acceleration, and we can talk about the kinetic energy of an object, we'll be using the position vector to describe these physical quantities. So as we look at it now, you should be able to determine what our acceleration is, our velocity is, and vice versa, using either the velocity or the acceleration to determine our position vector. On this note, we'll be drawing the curtain for this lecture. And so please, we should try to understand that motions of particles can be described based on vector understanding. You can describe the motions of particles based on vector understanding. And this will give us a better understanding of how particles move in the three dimensional coordinates. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Finish him. Kill the guy now. Grab the gun. Kill him.
What? What is this?
Good day, sir.
You are watching Jackie Pan in my house.
Who is King Kong, sir?
Eh? King Kong. You've never heard of ACTV before in your life. ACTV is very educative, informative, and there are football sport there. There is entertainment. There are a lot of things you can even attend lectures here. All you know is watch all those nonsense artists and do nonsense or you watch nonsense on TV. Eh? Last night you almost came in bed with your fist.
It's not me, sir.
Eh? And you wake up every morning, the bed will be so rough like you've been fighting for your dream. Eh? That's the reason why you have F's in your courses like
that. Especially
made for you.
I have it last semester.
E, we E by pounds on you. Very stupid though. We are changing that section to ACTV right now. And oh god, the baby wants to have been first born. Stupid boy.